vibration measuring instruments. So as you all know, second module is forced vibration, and mainly we are dealing with harmonic excitation and harmonic excitation. So harmonic excitation is F sine omega t. And you know, position, velocity, acceleration. Now, if input is F sine omega t, output will be X sine omega t with a phase difference of phi, minus phi. So position is X sine omega t, velocity is omega X sine omega t minus phi, or omega X cos omega t minus phi, or omega X sine omega t minus phi plus pi by 2. Acceleration will be minus omega square X. This is a basic thing you all know. Now, position, velocity, acceleration, and the frequency, for example, natural frequency of the vibrating system, are the parameters that we need to measure in order to study the vibration behavior. Position, velocity, and acceleration, how do you measure them? You measure by the amplitude, because they are not constant. They are sinusoidal. Okay. So we amplitude means peak, positive peak or negative peak. So let's say amplitude of the force is input is capital F. Amplitude of position will be capital X. Amplitude of velocity will be omega times capital X. Amplitude of acceleration will be omega square times capital X. Amplitudes of velocity and acceleration are multiplied by omega and omega square of the amplitude of the position. In order to, in addition to the above, you know, sometimes we need to measure the natural frequency of the system. There are certain instruments which can measure the natural frequency of the system. I'm not going to cover it today. But forcing frequency or frequency of excitation or frequency of the external force omega is already known. Now, this is a typical example of a vibration measuring instrument. The general term for vibration measuring instruments is called vibrometer. The construct and typical constructional feature of the vibrometer is shown in the top figure. Okay. Now, if you look at the bottom plate of the instrument is bolted to some other surface. Okay. So the instrument should be rigidly fixed to the surface. Suppose I want to measure the vibration of my car or my table, for example, then I must rigidly fix it there to that. So, and then when the table is vibrating, the instrument also will be vibrating. Look at inside the instrument. Inside the instrument, there is a mass M. This mass is called the inertial mass or seismic mass. Seismic mass is connected to the body of the instrument through a spring and damper, K and C. And you can say you are measuring the positive direction of X in the vertical direction. Now the table itself will be vibrating. So that is called support. The support itself is vibrating. So that is Y. So this is called support motion, and that is given by the schematic diagram of a spring mass system with the base or support. Okay. Now the mass M is vibrating. The base may also be vibrating. The base is vibrating sinusoidally, Y of t equal to capital Y sine omega t. The mass is also vibrating as capital X sine omega t minus phi. And this is the free body diagram. In the exam, whenever you draw the schematic diagram, you must also draw the free body diagram. Free body diagram will show the system plus whatever external forces are that are acting on it. Usually, you should not show MX double dot here. In the free body diagram, it's not shown. Only external forces are shown, and MX double dot will be equal to the sum of these external forces. This you must know already in your module one. Now, so the constructional feature of the vibrometers I have shown. There are three types of vibrometers. One type of vibrometers are called seismometers. One type of vibrometers are called seismometers. Seismometers are used for earthquake measurement. They basically measure position. Or in other words, their design is optimized for measuring position. Okay. There is also velocity measuring instrument. They are called velometers. velometers. They will measure velocity. And next one is called accelerometer. In fact, seismometers and accelerometers are very popular. Accelerometers are used for several experimental setups. So for industry, in the industrial setup or automobile engineering or aerospace, accelerometers are widely used. Accelerometers are also vibrometers. That the only difference between seismometer and accelerometer is in their natural frequency. Seismometers will have low natural frequency, whereas accelerometers will have high natural frequency. I'm going to the next slide. So, as you know, this the principle of operation of the system is nothing but support motion. That is why the formulas used for support motion will be used full here also. Examples of support motion are, of course, vibrometers. Also, earthquake is another example of base excitation or support motion. Machine table vibrations, you know, lathe vibration, milling machines, they are vibrating. Vertical motion of the wheels of the automobile is also support motion. So in the case of support motion or base excitation, the external excitation is in the form of a position change in the base. Okay, that will indirectly apply forces on the spring and damper, which will in turn induce vibration on the mass. Now, support motion is the input. Y of t is equal to capital Y sine omega t. Omega is the frequency of support motion or base excitation. Okay, so support motion means base excitation. Both are one and the same. Support means base. Motion means excitation. Now, the output of that will be the position response of the system. X of t equal to capital X sine omega t minus psi. Okay. Look at this. Psi. The symbol is psi, not phi. Now, there is something called relative displacement. You know, input is Y of t. Output is X of t. That means X of t is the absolute displacement of mass m, and Y of t is the absolute displacement of the base. The difference between the two is called Z of t, called relative displacement, X minus Y, Z sine omega t minus phi. Absolute displacement transmissibility. What is transmissibility? There is an input Y. So the amplitude of input Y is capital Y. And there is an output X of t, whose amplitude is X. The question is, if capital Y is the input amplitude, what will be the output amplitude, or what is the relation between X and Y? Remember, X is the output amplitude, Y is the input amplitude. The ratio between the two is called the transmissibility. And since X is the amplitude of displacement, and since X is the amplitude of absolute displacement, absolute position, this ratio is called absolute displacement transmissibility. Therefore, there is also Z, relative displacement. So there is a ratio Z divided by Y. We'll see about that later. And this formula, X divided by Y, is given by this formula. Okay. And the formula looks complicated, but in all the formulas that we use in module 2, the denominator is the same. Denominator is square root of 1 minus r square whole square plus 2 zeta r whole square. Okay. So only numerator will change. Numerator, there'll be three numerators. Number one, r square, r 1 plus 2 zeta r whole square. That's all. Okay. So you can easily remember this formula. I think all of you know what is r. R is called the frequency ratio. Omega divided by omega n. That is r. Okay, zeta, all of you know, zeta is nothing but C by CC. Zeta is called the damping factor or damping ratio. And C is called the damping coefficient. So you must know the difference. Damping coefficient is C. Damping factor or damping ratio is nothing but zeta equal to C divided by CC. So the formula is X divided by Y, square root of 1 plus 2 zeta or whole square divided by something. And let's not bother, look at this. This is Ft by F, and Ft is the force transmitted to the foundation, and F is the force input. Let's not bother about this now. Now let's bother about X divided by Y equal to some formula. Remember, you have to remember this formula. Now, there is a phase difference between X and Y. That phase difference is nothing but phi. Therefore, phi is equal to tan inverse of this quantity. Okay? There is a slightly some 5-6 steps of derivation is there. In some other session, I will show. In today's session, let's not bother about the derivation. You just know, take it for example, take it for granted that this formula is known to you. And when you write the final exam, you are expected to know this formula. So you have to remember this formula. Next slide. Relative displacement transmissibility. I told you we had X divided by Y. Now we are going to have the formula Z divided by Y. Z divided by Y, capital Z, amplitude of relative displacement, that is capital Z. Capital Y is amplitude of the input displacement or base excitation. That's equal to R squared divided by square root of 1 minus R squared whole square plus 2 zeta R whole square. Okay, this above formula is same as the rotational unbalance, so let's not bother about it now. Now, there is a phase difference between Z of t and Y of t. The phase difference between Z of t and Y of t is phi, whereas Z phase difference between X of t and Y of t is psi that we saw in the previous slide. In this slide, this one. This slide is very, very important as far as accelerometers and vibrometers and seismometers are concerned. This slide is a very important slide as far as vibration measuring instruments are concerned. Okay? So, and you know, look at this. This is nothing but numerator and denominator. This numerator, this will be the denominator. 2 zeta r is the numerator. 1 minus r square is the denominator. Relative displacement transmissibility is an important parameter in the case of vibrometers and seismometers, which measure the position and amplitude of vibration. Okay. And there is a last point, which is a very, very important point. Please note, in fact, you already gone through measurements and instruments course, I think. We want instruments to operate in a linear fashion. Okay. So if I have a thermometer, I want the divisions to have equally spaced. So if you want it to be equally spaced, the difference between the output and the input must be a constant. And if that constant is one, that is very good. So we want all vibration measuring instruments to operate in the range where Z divided by Y is equal to one or X divided by Y is equal to one. So now we know the meaning of X divided by Y and the meaning of Z divided by Y. Okay. So X divided by Y will be useful for accelerometers, whereas Z divided by Y will be useful in the analysis of seismometers. Okay, so now I'll quickly show what is X divided by Y. For various values of frequency ratio is defined as R equal to omega divided by omega n, and X divided by Y is shown here. Now, this is plotted for different values of zeta, different values of damping factor. Damping factor 0 to infinity you can plot. Okay, in this case, damping factor, this curve is damping factor 0 is not shown. Very low damping factor 0.05. Then damping factor 0.1. This is damping factor 0.05, 0.1. 0.2, 0.25, and this is 0.5 and 1. Okay, they have not plotted anything beyond 1. You can go up to infinity, no problem, but there is no use. Okay, now you look at the values square root of 2. You know, when the frequency ratio is square root of 2, then all the curves passes through 1, 1. Coordinate 1, 1. Frequency ratio is square root of 2. Frequency ratio is square root of 2, but the displacement ratio is x divided by y is equal to 1. That means if the input is 1, output is also 1. Let's say the speed breaker is 20 centimeter, then the passengers traveling in the car also will get a bump of 20 centimeter. Okay. That's the meaning. Okay. But when it is square root of 2, all of them have the same value of x divided by y. And this region that you see, all regions after square root of 2, there are high frequency regions, whereas lower than that are low frequency region. Okay. So most of the automobiles, we assume that they will operate at high frequency region, like 40 kilometer per hour and above. Okay. That's why automobile may not have dampers. Okay. A spring alone is enough. Whereas low frequency, you need damper also. At low speeds, some machinery that are running at low speed or some sensitive instruments that are operating. So you may need damper as well as spring. Okay. So now if zeta is zero, that means no damping at all, then omega by omega n equal to 1 means resonance. At resonance, amplitude will become infinity. Therefore, even if the input displacement is only 10 centimeter, output displacement will be infinity. So that's why you should always operating it. You should never operate near frequency ratio equal to 1 at resonance. Okay. So this is phi, and this is a corresponding phase difference curve. I am not discussing too much about it. Now let's come back. Here we, z divided by y is plotted against the frequency ratio. Frequency ratio, they are plotted from 0 to 5. That means 5 times the natural frequency. Why have they stopped at 5? You can also plot up to 10. But still, the characteristic will not be different because all the curve are reaching some constant value equal to 1. So even if you plot further towards the right hand side, you are not going to get significantly different pattern in the plot. Okay. So now, so z divided by y, of course, there is a peak. This peak always occurs less than, the peak always occurs more than frequency ratio after 1. Frequency ratio more than 1, then only the peak occurs, peak. Whereas in the previous figure, where is the peak occurring? Peak is occurring slightly less than 1. See, peak is occurring less than 1. Okay, and at resonance it will occur at frequency ratio is equal to 1. So this is another thing. Okay, now as I told you, seismometers are low frequency instruments. If they, that means their natural frequency is low. If natural frequency is less, the ratio will be high. Therefore, they'll be operating towards the right side of this graph. Whereas accelerometers, their natural frequency is high natural frequency. Therefore, the frequency ratio will be smaller. So this range is good for accelerometers. So I was talking about the range of accelerometer and vibrometer. Now, what is this? Now, as I told you, for vibrometers, you will use the Z divided by Y ratio to find out the characteristic curve. Okay. To find out, this figure and this figure are one and the same. So, but for accelerometer, there is one more characteristic curve. That is nothing but amplitude ratio. Okay, what is amplitude ratio? Amplitude ratio is nothing but this formula. This amplitude ratio is nothing but acceleration ratio. Okay, acceleration ratio m against amplitude ratio. Earlier, we saw displacement ratio, z divided by y or x divided by y. But for accelerometer, we should have acceleration ratio. Okay, so this acceleration ratio is plotted. Again, for this acceleration ratio, amplitude ratio or acceleration ratio, the peak occurs at r less than 1. Okay, so, and then as I told you, look at this, the range for accelerometer is somewhere here. That means frequency ratio less than 0.7. So frequency ratio less than 0.7. So I want to see the magnified view of this, portion that I will show in the next picture. So this picture and the previous picture are one and the same. Only thing is this portion is magnified here. And if I magnify, you'll find that this region, the ratio is approximately equal to 1. Okay. Therefore, this region is suitable for accelerometer operation. What you see now on the screen is the summary of all the formula used in module 2. It's a very interesting table. I took a lot of time to prepare. So, and I will advise you to remember this formula. So this is the magnification factor for harmonic excitation. This is the formula, 1 divided by the quantity within the square root. And this is the formula for peak value. And you should know how to derive this. This was taught in the class. And what is the formula for phase difference? This is the rotation unbalance. This is the formula. And this is the peak value. You must remember this formula in the last column. And you should know how to derive it. You should know the formula in the fourth column also, and you should know how to derive it. Then I'm going to the next page. Here, force transmissibility formula. Now let's look at 4A, formula number 4A. Formula number 4A, 4B, 5A, 5B, 5C, 5D are relevant to today's presentation. Okay. Now let's look at 5A. This is the formula, Z divided by Y formula. Okay. Now, what is the formula for peak value? Peak value formula is same as this one, same as in. So I will share this with you. Okay. As in serial number 2A. So 2A, this is peak value for this. Okay. So this formula we have taught today, X by Y, Z by Y formula we have taught today. This is nothing but the accelerometer or seismometer. Formula number 4A, 5A, and 5C are very important to us. Formula number 5C is for accelerometer. Now look at this formula, accelerometer ratio. So that is given by 1 divided by square root of 1 minus r square whole square plus 2 zeta r whole square. Velometer also may be there. You know, velometer, you know, acceleration is omega square z, okay? Whereas velocity is omega multiplied by z. So therefore, velocity ratio is omega n z divided by omega times capital Y. That's equal to 1 by r multiplied by z by y. Okay, this formula will be required when we solve some problems. Look at this one interesting problem. Vehicle of mass 500 kg. And the suspension system of equivalent stiffness. The road undulations are like this. Okay. Find out the critical speed. Find out the amplitude of the steady state motion of the vehicle and amplitude of the steady state motion of the mass when the vehicle is going at 60 km per hour. Let's see some accelerometer or something related to question. Another thing, there is a vehicle. M is the vehicle. This is the wheel. So this is going over sinusoidal undulation, then what type of vibration will occur? So we can use those formulas and solve. This is a very interesting question related to instrument vibration. No, this is again support motion. A precision instrument whose mass is 20 kg, it must be isolated from a vibrating machine. So precision instrument of mass 20 kg, it is kept on a machine. The machine is vibrating. Therefore, the precision instruments must be, vibration should not be transmitted from the machine to the instrument. And if at all vibration is transmitted to the precision instrument, the amplitude of the vibration should be restricted to 0.05 mm. That means it must be the vibration of the machine may be anything, but the vibration of the precision instrument should be only 50 microns. When the machine is running at 500 RPM, the instrument is mounted on four isolators, each having a spring stiffness of 32 kN per meter and damping coefficient of 400. C is equal to 400 Newton second per meter. So what is the amplitude of vibration of the instrument? What is the dynamic load on? So this is vibration isolation problem, support motion problem. It's a very interesting vibrometer or seismometer problem, which we can solve using the formula 5A, 5B, 5C we have seen. Now, this is a vibrometer. This vibrometer must measure, any measurement should be less than 1% error. The natural frequency of the instrument is 5 hertz and damping ratio is 0.2. So natural frequency means K divided by M whole, square root of K divided by M multiplied by 2 pi is given. Okay, and C is also given. Damping ratio 0.2. Natural frequency 5 hertz. Therefore, omega n is 2 pi fn. Then the error, what is the error? Z divided by y, okay. Z minus y is the error. That error in Z should be less than 1%, mean less than 0.01. Therefore, now by multiplying this here and there, you can find out the relation between Z and Z is 1.01. Z must be less than 1.01. Then only the measurements will be less than 1% error. Therefore, Z divided by Y is 1.01. So now we know Z divided by Y is given in the problem as 1.01. And the formula is this one. It's a vibrometer formula, so we directly use Z divided by Y. As I told you, vibrometer is a low frequency instrument. Natural frequency will be low. Omega n of a vibrometer is low, whereas omega n of an accelerometer is high. That's the question. That's the thing, right? So now, how low I should go? Okay, that is the question. How low I should go? So lowest frequency of a vibrometer to measure within less than 1% error. Less than 1% error. Charan Babu.
Sir.
What is your question?
Sir, how low can you go, sir?
How low?
Yes, sir, the frequency.
I think I'll have to refer some research literature to find out how low okay. We can go. So, if you take earthquake frequency is low. When earthquake comes, it's not a high frequency. Machine vibration is 500 RPM, 1000, 5000 RPM, even
5000.
Yeah. Your car, if you look at the speedometer of your car, dashboard of your car, so the RPM meter has a range from 0 to about 5,000. There are...
Sir, during earthquake that in car...
No, I am talking about automobile now. Okay?
Oh, okay.
So for example, automobile, A car, for example, usually it operates, the engine of a car runs from 1000 to 2000 RPM. Okay?
Correct.
That is the 2000 divided by 60 is the natural frequency, is the frequency of excitation. Okay? So it's pretty high. Whereas
earthquake is low.
Pardon?
Earthquake is low, sir.
Yeah, please do not interrupt. I'll allow you time to ask question. Okay? But just listen.
Okay.
Two, three sentences. So, for example, an automobile engine runs from 1000 to 2000 RPM. If you want to know in hertz, divided by 60. That is the speed. But suppose you are a passenger in a car. The vibration you will feel, that will be 10 to 20 hertz. If you look at earthquake is not something like 20 hertz. If there is an earthquake, for example, sea wave. Sea wave frequency is something like 1 hertz. In 1 second or even 2 seconds, 3 seconds, you will get 1 wave, right? So it's a low frequency. So if tsunami comes, tsunami frequency will be something like 1 hertz or even half hertz, like that. So if there is an earthquake, that much will be the vibration.
So
he asked me how low you can go in designing.
I guess I have answered the question.
That depends on what measurement you have to make. So if you want to measure earthquake, then your instrument should have a natural frequency of the order of 1 hertz or less than 10 hertz, something like that. Now let's come back to the problem. So this is a given data. 5 hertz, that converted to radians per second, is 31.42. Zeta is given in the problem. And error must be less than 1%. That is Z minus Y by Y. Z minus Y is the error. That must be less than 1%, 0.01. That is equivalent to 1.01 Y. That means Z divided by Y equal to 1.01. So since I have this formula, I can direct, left hand side of the formula is known. Right hand side is r squared divided by square root of 1 minus r square whole square plus 2 zeta r. So zeta is known to me. Zeta is known to me. R is the frequency ratio which is unknown. So in this equation, the only thing unknown is r. So you have to find out this value of r. So by moving it to the numerator, denominator, left hand side, right hand side, you do all this gimmicks, mathematical jugglery. Then if I move everything to the left hand side, right hand side, so I will get an equation which is polynomial in terms of R. Okay. Now, how will you solve this equation?
I'm getting a computer
an equation in terms of R4, but it is actually
in the exam quadratic in R square.
You have to solve it without using.
So you can solve this problem
do it by hand easily.
Trial and error.
So by solving it as a quadratic equation in terms of R square, I get R square equal to 92. Therefore, R is equal to 9.6. I get two solutions because it's a quadratic equation in R square. So you get R square equal to 92 or R square is 0.5. Corresponding value of R, take the square root of 92, it is 9.6. Take the square root of 0.5, it is 0.7. Okay. So my frequency ratio for the given problem is either 9.6 or 0.7. Only one of them is correct. Only one of them is correct. Okay. So as I told you, seismometers are low frequency instruments, that means high value of R. Value of R equal to omega by omega will be high. So I should choose this. If it is an accelerometer problem, then I will choose R equal to 0.739. So once I have chosen R is equal to 9.636, then I have to find out what R is equal to omega by omega n. That is also equal to F divided by Fn. Okay. So therefore Fn is given as 5 hertz in the problem. Therefore F is R multiplied by Fn, 9.636 multiplied 5. So 46.18. So this should be the natural frequency, the minimum allowable natural frequency. I think we are coming back to the question asked by one of the student. Sir, how low I can go? How low frequency is allowable? This problem answers this. So what should be the natural frequency of the seismometer depends on what frequency or what, how much accuracy you want, how much precision you want. What is the implication for going lower than the allowable value? Error will increase. And how will you change the frequency of the system? The parameters are K, C, and M. Okay, K, C, and M. Okay, so K is the spring, whatever spring available in the market, I have to buy. Whatever damper available in the market, I have to buy. So the only thing that I can modify is the mass of the system. So the value of M, value of the seismic mass M, I can increase or decrease easily. So therefore, omega N is equal to square root of K by M. So if I have a higher value, then I am going for a lower and lower frequency. Continue, Viswanath.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Like when the frequency, you said the RPM, right?
Yeah, frequency is nothing but RPM, man. See, frequency or RPM are one and the same. Frequency multiplied by 60 is RPM.
So for example,
frequency is hertz. Hertz means per second. This is per minute. So you are just multiplying by 60. For example, in the previous problem, 5 hertz. 5 hertz means 60 multiplied by 5, 300 RPM. Okay. If it's a rotating machinery. Okay. RPM is relevant for rotating machinery. Revolutions per minute or revolutions per 5 hertz means 5 RPS. Sometimes they use RPS.
Yes.
You'll find seismometers are very big instruments because K by M should be very low. If K by M should be very low, M should be very large. If M is very large, K by M is very low. So seismometers will be a little bit heavy instruments. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Something like, 500 grams, 200 grams, or even 1 kg, something like that. Whereas accelerometers, even your cell phone has an accelerometer. Okay. So, in terms of principle, accelerometer and seismometer, both are same. Both are principal construction features are same. So now the next problem, an accelerometer is made with a crystal of natural frequency 22 hertz. You know, even our cell phone has an accelerometer and you can buy an accelerometer for 100 rupees outside. Multi-axis accelerometers are available. It's a MEMS device. MEMS accelerometers are available. Cell phone has an accelerometer, gyro. They are also MEMS devices. They use a crystal as a seismic mass. Okay. They are using a crystal as a seismic mass. There are different ways a MEMS device may be made. In this case, they made it with a crystal. Okay. So you are also using crystal in quartz watches and all electronic instruments. For example, you have a processor, computer or cell phone processor of say 10 gigahertz, 8 gigahertz. Okay. So that they are also crystals. So that indicates acceleration frequency. Question. An accelerometer is made with a crystal of natural frequency 22 kilohertz. Now the damping factor of the accelerometer is 0.7. Estimate the maximum allowable frequency that will ensure that the error is less than 1%. Acceleration error, measurement error of the accelerometer should be less than 1%. So these are the given data. Fn is 22,000. Zeta is 0.7. Now error y minus z divided by y must be less than 0.1. Okay. Therefore, z is equal to 0.99 y. You understand one point. I have taken 0.99. I have not taken 1.01. Understand? y minus z. So if you take 1.01, then it will, error will be more. So z divided by y is 0.99. Now z divided by y is the relative amplitude ratio, but we are interested in acceleration ratio. If y is the capital Y is the amplitude of the sub excitation, omega square y is the amplitude of acceleration, z is the amplitude of relative displacement, omega n square z is the amplitude of the relative displacement of the mass. Since y is the input, we are using omega. Z is the output, we are using omega n, because z refers to the displacement of the mass or displacement of the system. Therefore, you should use omega n here. So omega n square divided by omega square y, that is nothing but z divided by y. Now z divided by y, if you see, the numerator was r square, denominator was this same as what you see here. So now what is omega divided by omega n? That is r. Omega n divided by omega is 1 by r. Omega n square divided by omega square is 1 by r square. So 1 by r square multiplied by z by y is nothing but this. Left hand side is given, 0.99 is given. So z divided by this one, left hand side is given. Left hand side, this is not z divided by y. This should be omega n square z divided by omega n square y equal to 0.99. So the left hand side of the problem is known. So right hand side, there is only one variable. So by squaring, I am squaring both sides, 0.99 square equal to this. Okay. So I am expanding 1 minus r square whole square. And then I am summing these two. If I sum, after summing these two, I am bringing this denominator to the left hand side. So 0.99 multiplied by this quantity is this, is equal to 1. This one, this one is. Simplify this further. So you get 0.99 square multiplied by this. Okay. This quantity within the bracket is nothing but this. Now, if you look at this, this is nothing but, it's a quadratic equation in terms of r square. So I can solve it easily. So I am further simplifying this, dividing throughout by 0.99. So it will be r power 4 minus 0.04 r square minus 1, okay, minus of 1 divided by 0.9. This equation is quadratic in r square whole square, 0.04 r square. So you can solve it using r square equal to minus b by 2a plus r minus square root of b square minus 4ac divided by 2a formula. So by solving that, I get two values for r square. R square equal to 0.22 or r square equal to minus 0.18. Right? Remember, r is the frequency ratio. You can't have a negative values for frequency. Therefore, this is simply rejected. The only valid value is r square equal to 0.2215. That means take square root of 0.2215, it is nothing but r equal to 0.47. See, remember, compare the previous problem and this problem. In the previous problem, what was the value of r we got? We got a value of r equal to around 10, frequency ratio around 10. Whereas here, we get a frequency ratio of 0.4. Now let's come back to the problem. So in our problem, we have found out for the accelerometer problem, the frequency ratio omega divided by omega n is equal to 0.4706. So r is equal to this one. So f is equal to r multiplied by fn. R is 0.47 and fn given in the problem is 22 kilohertz. Every crystal has a frequency. Okay. Usually MEMS accelerometers are made of cantilever beam. You'll have a small MEMS cantilever. At the end of a cantilever, the crystal will be connected. So you can always find out the natural frequency of cantilever beam. That's how you got the 22 kilohertz. So the F is 10.35 hertz. 22 kilohertz is a natural frequency. Okay. But the frequency is 10.35. So maximum allowable frequency is 10.35 kilohertz. Okay. So therefore, estimate the maximum allowable frequency. For example, if the vibration is more than 10, if the vibration is more than 10, then error will be more than 1%. Okay. So more than 10 kilohertz, 10.35 kilohertz. The natural frequency is 22 kilohertz, but the frequency ratio is about 0.47. Therefore, the external, that vibration that you want to measure, am I right? Excitation frequency should be less than 10.35 kilohertz. A seismic instrument is mounted on a machine that is running at 1500 RPM. The natural frequency of the instrument is 20 radians per second. The instrument records a relative amplitude. Relative amplitude means Z, capital Z of 0.6 mm. Compute the displacement, velocity, and acceleration of the machine. Assume the damping factor is negligible. Okay, so this is the given data. These are the formula that we'll use. Okay, you will assume that the damping factor is negligible. That means you can assume zeta equal to zero. Therefore, R squared divided by square root of 1 minus R squared is this one. So you can calculate these things. Then next problem, design a velometer if the maximum error should be less than 2% of the actual velocity. The natural frequency of the velocimeter is 75 hertz and the suspended mass or seismic mass is 0.08 kg, very low, 80 grams only. Okay, this is the given data. Then, K equal to m omega n square. So you can find out the value of K, stiffness. Then you can find out the damping ratio. To find out the damping, this is Z divided by Y. R is equal to Z divided by Y equal to this one. Then you can find out the value of damping ratio, because they've given this capital R, no? They've given capital R, then find out the maximum value at which damping occurs. So you can solve it for zeta. So solving the Auer quadratic equation, you get zeta square two values. So from which you can find the value of zeta. So only one real number you are getting. So from that, you can find out what should be the damping coefficient of the problem. So velocimeter must be defined with the spring stiffness of 17 Newton per meter and damping coefficient should be 48. So I think we have seen some four problems today. Biswajit, please speak.
Sir, there in that acceleration amplitude ratio, 1 by R square into Z by Y, and the formula is given, sir. Whether that 1 by R square is eliminated or even that is counted in the formula. Yes, sir.
Yeah, here, what is your question? This is formula number 5C.
Yes, sir. Here the 1 by R square into Z by Y is there, no, sir. Whether this 1 by R square is eliminated or it is considered, sir.
It gets eliminated because in the original formula, Z by Y is R square divided by numerator, R square divided by denominator. Now that Z by Y has R square in the numerator and I'm dividing by R square. So that gets canceled. That's why numerator is simply one.
Oh, okay. So that was the doubt, sir.